a very warm welcome to you, congregation. I see we have quite a few visitors, so a very warm welcome to you as well. Some very familiar faces, so we pray we would be richly blessed as we worship our God together. If you're tuning in live stream, please do feel welcome. Even though we are far away, we pray that you would be as part of this service as much as possible. There is one announcement that is also in the bulletin, and that is from next week we will be shifting to the ESV Bible, and there will be pew Bibles, but if you would like your own one, now would be an opportune time to purchase one, because our new pew Bibles will be the ESV. And we do welcome Reverend Graeme Zuidema to the pulpit for us.
Well, good morning, congregation. Lovely to be in your midst this morning once again. Our call to worship comes from Psalm 62, and we'll be reading verses 5 to 6 of Psalm 62. It says these words: "Find rest, O my soul, in God alone. My hope comes from Him. He alone is my rock and my salvation. He is my fortress. I shall not be shaken. My salvation and my honor depend on God. He is my mighty rock, my refuge. Trust in Him. Trust in Him at all times, so people, pour out your hearts to Him, for God is our refuge." Well, in light of these words, let us come to our God in prayer. So please pray with me. The gracious God and Father in heaven, it is of great comfort to us that we can indeed find rest in you alone, through your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you that our hope in the midst of the storms is in you. It is in you that we worship and adore. It is you, O God, that alone is our rock, our refuge. And so help us by your Spirit to trust in you, to pour out our hearts to you in worship this morning. So bless us, we pray, and we do pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Will the congregation please stand? When the storms of life are upon us, it is crucial to know where our help comes from. And so, congregation, let us confess together where our help comes from by saying, "Our help is in the name of the Lord, the Maker of heaven and earth. Amen." And our triune God, he greets us with these words: "Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, with the fellowship of the Holy Spirit. Amen." Well, let's sing praise to our God by singing Sing to the Lord 62, and we'll sing verses 1, 4, and 5. Verses 1, 4, and 5 of Psalm 62: "My soul finds rest in God alone." Well, if you could turn in your Bibles to Exodus 20. Exodus 20. Over recent months, Pastor Flynn has been taking us through the Exodus account, and we read in the Exodus accounts that the Lord, Yahweh, through Moses, stops the sea. He stops the seas so that he can rescue his people. The Lord has power, not just over people, but he has power over all creation. The Lord was with his people. He rescued them. He calmed the sea. He saved them from utter destruction. And it's in view of this most marvelous work that informs God's holy law. It's grounded in grace and mercy. And so let us read Exodus 20, and we'll read verses 1 to 21 of Exodus 20. And God spoke all these words, "I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an idol in the form of anything in heaven above, or on the earth beneath, or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing the children for the sin of the fathers to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing love to 1,000 generations of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not hold anyone guiltless who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work. But the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, neither you nor your son or daughter, nor your manservant or maidservant, nor your animals, nor the alien within your gates. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea and all that is in them. But he rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. Honor your father and your mother, so that you may live long in the land the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not give false testimony against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife or his manservant or maidservant, his ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor." When the people saw the thunder and lightning and heard the trumpet and saw the mountain in smoke, they trembled with fear. They stayed at a distance and said to Moses, "Speak to us yourself and we will listen, but do not have God speak to us or we will die." Moses said to the people, "Do not be afraid. God has come to test you, so that the fear of God will be with you to keep you from sinning." The people remained at a distance while Moses approached the thick darkness where God was. So far, the reading from God's word. The law is grounded in grace and mercy. But as we read here, the law restrains people from sinning, and yet we know we sin. We break God's grace-filled commandments, and so we need to repent from our sins. We need to turn to our gracious God for forgiveness. And so, yes, at times, we at times can be overwhelmed by our sins, and not just overwhelmed by our sins, but overwhelmed by others' sins against and actions against us. The storms of this life can get the better of us at times. But thanks be to our faithful God, who says in Psalm 65, "When we were overwhelmed by sins, you forgave our transgressions, our sins. And of course, this forgiveness was ultimately achieved in and through Yahweh, the Lord, in the person of the Son. And so let's stand and sing together Psalm 65b, and we'll read it in a moment as well. But it's a psalm of assurance of salvation. So let's stand and sing all stanzas of 65b, Thy might sets fast the mountains. I can now turn to Psalm 65, and Ron Voskersing will read this psalm for us. And as he's making his way up here, we're reading this psalm, Psalm 65, because we see there in verse 7, who stilled the roaring seas. This is a reference, of course, to the Exodus, but we'll see later in our text that Jesus stills the roaring sea. So Psalm 65, thanks, Ron.
Psalm 65, for the director of music, a psalm of David, a song. Praise awaits you, O God in Zion. To you our vows will be fulfilled. O you who hear prayer, to you all men will come. When we were overwhelmed by sins, you forgave our transgressions. Blessed are those you choose and bring near to live in your courts. We are filled with the good things of your house, of your holy temple. You answer us with awesome deeds of righteousness. Our God and Saviour, the hope of all the ends of the earth and of the farthest seas, who formed the mountains by your power, and having armed yourself with strength, who stilled the roaring of the seas, the roaring of their waves, and the turmoil of the nations. Those living far away fear your wonders, where morning dawns and evening fades. You call forth songs of joy. You care for the land and water it. You enrich it abundantly. The streams of God are filled with water to provide the people with grain, for so you have ordained it. You drench its furrows and level its ridges. You soften it with showers and bless its crops. You crown the year with your bounty, and your carts overflow with abundance. The grasslands of the desert overflow, The hills are clothed with gladness. The meadows are covered with flocks, and the valleys are mantled with grain. They shout for joy and sing. So far the reading.
Well, at this time, we'll now come to our God in the prayer of intercession. I was speaking to some of you know him, but Reverend Bram Janssen van Rensburg, asking him how things were in Nelson with the congregation there. He said that the congregation there, none of them have been affected by the floods or about the storm, so that's great news. And of course, they're helping out people in that area as well. But we can give thanks that those within the Nelson congregation are safe and sound, but of course there's a lot of clean-up work to do in that area of Nelson. So we'll pray for Nelson and a few other things that we'll pray that have been mentioned in this week's bulletin and also last week's bulletin as well. So let's come to our God in prayer. The gracious Father in heaven, we once again come before your throne of grace, knowing that we can, because of our Saviour, the Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you that your power and might is seen all throughout Scripture, but is also seen in the present, that you so powerfully and graciously keep us. And we do thank you that you have and you are keeping your people through the storms and floods in Nelson. And we do pray that you would be with the Nelson Reformed Church as they obviously help others in that area in need. And Father, we do give you thanks that again, that our more senior members can also know that you keep them. We do pray for them all, as life is grand, but frailty of life is a struggle that many of them face. And not just them, but we all see that life is faced with many storms that can be hard to navigate. Father, we do want to pray for those that are struggling with their health, be that with a cold or flu or with a debilitating disease. Father, you are most merciful and gracious. You are our great carer. But we do find it hard at times when things are not easy. And so may you pour out your Spirit upon us, that we may know that you are near. May we be reminded by your word that you never forsake us, but care for us. Father, we do want to remember our families and relationships. We pray for those that are near, here and far away. Father, we thank you so much for our families. We thank you for those that can visit us from afar and for those that live close by. We pray also that where there are tensions within families, that you would bring peace. We pray for those that are nearing the end of their earthly lives or are very ill, that they may truly know you. In this regard, we do continue to pray for Nico's brother Peter. Be with Nico and Caroline as they care, even from a distance, for Peter and his wider family. Father, we also want to pray for those that are grieving. Especially want to pray for Johan and Ria as they grieve the loss of Johan's brother, Hank. May Johan and Ria know that you are the God of all comfort. We pray not only for them, but also others of us that have lost loved ones. So may we continue to experience your grace and mercy in our times of need. Father, we do thank you for safe journeys that we do every day, and we especially thank you for bringing Janice Reed home safely from her time away. We take so much for granted when we travel, but we know that by your power and might that you uphold and sustain this world and us. What a great comfort and blessing this is for us. And so with gratefulness, but also with great assurance, we bring these prayers and petitions before your throne of grace in and through the Lord Jesus Christ. And it's in his name we pray. Amen. Well, out of gratefulness of our salvation in Christ, we give to the Lord's work. And so now you'll be waited upon for your gifts and offering, which will be for the work of this local church. Thank you.
So we just bring these offerings before the Lord in prayer. Gracious Lord, we're grateful that you've brought us together again as a congregation and allowing us the opportunity to worship you this morning. We thank you for how you bless us, not only when the times are good, but also give us strength and perseverance when times are tough. We ask for your blessing on the offerings we bring before you today, and ask that by your Spirit you'll equip us deacons to administer these gifts so they'll become a blessing unto many. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Well, before the further reading and preaching of God's word, let us stand again and sing to the Lord 504, Be Still My Soul.
Thank you.
Well, if we could turn in your Bibles to Mark 4, verses, we're going to read verses 35 to 41. Next week, I will remember to send the Sunday school students out. I'll get into the habit of that soon. And so Mark 4, and we'll be reading verses 35 to 41. Mark 4, starting at verse 35. That day when evening came, he said to his disciples, that is Jesus, "Let us go over to the other side." Leaving the crowd behind, they took him along, just as he was, in the boat. There were also other boats with him. A furious squall came up, and the waves broke over the boat so that it was nearly swamped. Jesus was in the stern, sleeping on a cushion. The disciples woke him and said to him, "Teacher, don't you care if we drown?" He got up, rebuked the wind, and said to the waves, "Quiet, be still." Then the wind died down, and it was completely calm. He said to his disciples, "Why are you so afraid? Do you still have no faith?" They were terrified and asked each other, "Who is this? Even the wind and the waves obey him." So far, the reading of God's word. May he write its eternal truths upon our hearts. Well, one of the questions when someone new walks into the room is, "Who is this? Who is this?" You're at a family reunion, and a family member arrive with their new girl or boyfriend, and you're like, "Who is this? Who is this?" You've come to church this morning, and you've gone, "Who's this new guy preaching?" Or you're tuned in online, "Who's this new guy preaching? I haven't seen him before. I wonder how long he will go for this morning." And it's a common question we have when we don't know someone. But the funny thing is, we sometimes even do this when we do know who it is. We will say things like, who is this? Look at how they have matured. Look at how they are putting Jesus first in their lives. It seems like we now see who they really are. Who is this? Who is this? But there is a question that we should all answer, and many of us have already asked this at one point of time or another. Who is Jesus? Who is Jesus? And we can ask this when we have never heard of him before. But as Christians, we can also ask this from time to time. We can have times in our lives when we question, "Who is Jesus to me?" We can ask, "Does Jesus really care for me? Why do these storms of life continue to rush over me? Can Jesus really identify with all my struggles? Is it really that important that Jesus is not only truly man, but he's also truly God? Who are you, Jesus, to me?" This morning, I'm really building on what I preached on at the end of July, that on Christ the solid rock we stand, because all other ground is sinking sand. And we'll build on this by looking at Mark 4, verses 35 to 41. This wonderful, surprising and frightening accounts will describe to us who Jesus really is and why we must know him as we go through stormy times. And we'll notice four scenes, and the first is the storm. The first is the storm. One of the things that I miss about living in Sydney, Australia, is the storms. When I was in my late teens, and I'm not advocating that children here do this or even teenagers do this, but we used to, my sister Pam and I, we used to sit on the roof of the house, don't do this children, and we would watch the storms come into Sydney, and they have some ferocious lightning storms. And when it got to about, you know, 2 seconds away, you know how you count, then we would go inside. Probably waited a bit too long. But when I was a little child, I was frightened when storms would come. And so we used to, my sister and I, we used to run and jump into mum and dad's bed to find security. Well, disciples with Jesus are going to experience a storm. And we see this takes place after Jesus has been teaching solid for some time. Jesus is exhausted, and it's time for him to change locations. So after he had finished teaching many things by parables, the sower, the lamp, the growing seed, and the mustard seed, all showing how the kingdom of God has come in Jesus, he told his disciples in verse 35, "Let us go over to the other side of the lake." Verse 36, leaving the crowd behind, they took him along just as he was in the boat. Disciples were willing followers of Jesus. They obeyed his command. And it seems to me that they took him along just as he was is already hinting that Jesus is tired. He didn't get out of the boat since he first got into it in chapter 4, verse 1. And so these disciples, many of them avid fishermen, hopped in the boats and began to sail. Not just them, but there were other boats with them. In other words, there's going to be other witnesses to watch what is about to take place. Verse 37, furious squall came up and the waves broke over the boat so that it was nearly swamped. Now, the lake that Mark is referring to is the Sea of Galilee. It is a lake. It's about 200 meters below sea level. And it's about 166 square kilometers. So it's not a small lake. It's about 13 kilometers from one side to the other side. And at its southern end is a deep cliff-lined valley. And what is common for this lake is that the wind will funnel through the surrounding hills and through this valley, and it can cause a sudden violent storms on the lake. And Jesus is experiencing, and his disciples are experiencing, one of these storms. A furious squall came up and the waves broke over the boat. And we used to live in Christchurch, and we've travelled the ferry crossing a few times. That's an interesting ferry crossing when the weather is not the best. And we came on it once, and we were on this when the kids were quite small, and let me just say it wasn't pretty. There was a lot of people who were seasick on that boat, but it was a furious squall, not as big as this, but it was quite a storm. I've spoken to some folk in Pukekohe, and some of them are avid fishermen here this morning as well, I see, and they've been caught up in furious squalls as well, and I don't know you well enough yet, and whether or not you go out fishing, maybe some of you have been caught up in a furious squall. But if you haven't, you've obviously seen it on TV or something. You know what a furious squall looks like. A furious sea looks like a storm that just batters the boat and the people in it. Sometimes in our lives, our boat that we are sailing feels like it's getting battered by all sorts of storms. You see, even Christians cannot avoid the storms of this life. ones that come about by nature, like the ones that we've seen in Nelson across New Zealand, but also in our daily lives. Here are the disciples with the Saviour. They are following him wherever he goes. They've believed in Jesus. They have taken up their cross and are following them. And yet here they were being tossed about by a momentous storm. Please don't expect a smooth journey to heaven. Please don't expect it to be plain sailing all throughout your life. This does not happen for Christians. As COVID-19 has shown us, we should expect sickness, hurt, disappointment, and pain. But the question in all of this is, where is Jesus? Has he fallen asleep on the job? Well, that's what the disciples think. He was in the stern, that's the back of the boat, sleeping on a cushion. There's a storm, Jesus. What are you doing sleeping? But here's a precious thing, one of many that we can notice about this. Jesus got tired. He's exhausted. Sure, many of you have experienced this, but you come home from a hard day's worth of work or activities on a day or at school, and you come home and you're exhausted, and you sit down in your trusty, lazy boy chair and you nod off. You find yourself sound asleep. Jesus is sound asleep. This is quite encouraging for us. Jesus is truly human. He had a real body. He needed sleep. Jesus is like us in every way, but without sin. He knows our weaknesses. He got tired. He can sympathize with us. But we can also notice that his sleeping testifies his complete confidence in his power over creation. Well, the disciples, they are frightened and they go over to the sleeping Jesus and respectfully but urgently cry out, "Teacher, don't you care if we drown?" They are worried. They are going through this storm and they are convinced that Jesus has forgotten about them. Perhaps you are going through a momentous storm at the moment in your life, and maybe, just maybe, you've cried out to Jesus, "Don't you care? Don't you care that we are getting swamped by all these troubles and turmoil? Don't you care, Jesus?" Yes, I know, Jesus, that you can identify with us, that you are our faithful high priest, that you are able to sympathize with us, with our weaknesses. But where are you, Jesus? Are you sleeping? Is that where some of you are at? Perhaps the storm has nearly got the better of you. Are you there, Jesus? Do I know you? Well, thankfully, the account does not end with an open-ended question such as this. It's not one of those movies that finish and you're still left with a whole heap of questions. And so the second scene we notice is the power. Jesus, obviously, he woke up. He got up. And he rebuked the wind and said to the waves, "Quiet, be still." The wind died down and it was completely still. This is unheard of. A raging seas with swells swamping the boats, the avid fishermen convinced that if something doesn't happen soon, they will all die. And in an instant, the lake is calm. What's happening here? Well, Jesus is proving once again that he is God, that he is not only truly man, but he's also truly God, that he has not only authority in his teaching over demons and sickness, can forgive people of all their sins, but over all creation as well. No wonder why he is sleeping so soundly on the cushion. And the reason we can be so confident that this is the case, because it just oozes Old Testament references. Now, the original readers of Mark would think, this sounds awfully familiar. Where have I heard this before? Oh, that's where. It's in the Exodus account. Here, God, Yahweh, God's personal name, rebukes the Red Sea and saves the Israelites from the Egyptians. They'd recall numerous other passages in Isaiah, but also the psalm which we read before from Psalm 65. The Lord stilled the roaring seas. You see, Jesus is making plain to the disciples and to us that he is Almighty God. That he is the Lord, the covenant-keeping God in the person of the Son. Who is this, you ask? It is the Lord Jesus, God Almighty. And this is a great reminder for us as God's people. With the Lord Jesus Christ, nothing is impossible. When we are going through the storms of life, do not forget that Jesus is God, that he is sovereign over all things, that he by his Spirit is working all things out for the good of his people, for the glory of his name. Remember that those of us that trust in Jesus as our Lord and Savior, that when trials and tribulations come, we are in the boat with Jesus. Who is this? It is the Lord Jesus Christ. But do you know him? Do you know him? And that leads well onto the third scene that we notice. Jesus' questions in verse 40, where he asked the disciples two questions. Why are you so afraid? Do you still have no faith? Now, is this a rebuke to the disciples? Well, in some ways it is. Surely the disciples have seen enough to know that Jesus is God in the person of the Son. They may have seen him say to the evil spirit in chapter 1, "Be quiet." And it's the same word here used in our passage. They may have seen him heal so many people already, and not forgetting the miraculous healing of the paralytic. Surely, disciples, come on. Come on, disciples. You have seen enough. You have Almighty God in the person of the Son sitting in the boat. Where is your faith? So perhaps this is a rebuke of sorts. And yet, it seems to me that there is a better argument to be made, that it's also words of comfort. That when the lake is calm, and he looks to his disciples and says, "Why are you so afraid? I haven't left you. I'm right here with you. I'm in the boat. Stop resting in your own faith to save you and trust in me as the object of your faith." a faith that was given to you by God through the work of His Holy Spirit. You see, they had accepted Jesus' Messiahship, but all the conclusions from it they had not yet drawn. And Jesus is patient with them. He doesn't say, you know what, disciples, once we hit the shore, I'm out of here. I've had enough to do with you lot. No, he doesn't say that. He doesn't say that. And so even here, we see that Jesus, our Saviour and Lord, He sees weaknesses. He sees defects in our love and hope, and believe it or not, even in our courage. He graciously gives us Mark 4, verses 35 to 41, and says, why are you so afraid, dear Christian? Do you still have no faith? Trust in me alone for your salvation. Know that I'm here for you in the storms of your life. I'm in the boat. Jesus, who is truly man and truly God, says, I am with you. Who is this? It is the Lord Jesus Christ. But do you know him? Do you know him? So we've seen three scenes: the storm, the power, the questions. Who is this? We are getting a pretty clear picture of who it is: the Lord Jesus Christ, who is truly man and truly God. He has power over all things. And in this instance, it is seen clearly with the calming of the lake. But finally, what response do we give when we are in the presence of Almighty God? Verse 41. They were terrified. You see, there is one thing more terrifying than having a storm outside of the boat. It was having God in the boat. Who is this? Even the wind and the waves obey him. It's just dawned on the disciples who this is. It is Jesus Christ, God's one and only Son. This is who it is. He is the image of the invisible God. For by him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible. Whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things were created by him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. This is who is in the boat with the disciples. And there's only one response when you're in the presence of Almighty God and his power. And what is it? Fear, reverence, awe. And so the disciples are responding in the exact right manner to the Lord God Almighty. But is this your response? Do you know him? Are you awestruck by Jesus? Do you repent from your sin and trust in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? Who is this? Do you know him? Because how will we ever be saved from the dreadful storm called sin that keeps us from seeing the Father in the heaven? Sin which we all inherited from Adam at the beginning. And we in our original state are not worthy and thus should be terrified of God's wrath that is to come. But fear not. But fear not this morning if you trust in Jesus. Because of God's love, he sent Jesus to live the perfect life on this earth. He did not sin, and he died on the cross for all the sins of those who trust in him. Jesus, as truly God, by the power of his divinity, bore the weight of God's anger in his humanity. And we can now say with the centurion in Mark 15, who witnessed the crucifixion, surely this man is the Son of God. We can say with Thomas, upon Jesus' resurrection, my Lord and my God. And we say with the Apostle Paul, upon Jesus' ascension and the sending of the Spirit, that nothing will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. And we say with the Apostle John, as we wait for the day Jesus returns, worthy, worthy, worthy are you, Lord God Almighty. So as Christians, we say who this is, don't we? Jesus is our Lord and Savior. And he is in the boat with us. But do you know him? Do you believe in him? If not, repent from your sin and place your trust in Jesus, because we as God's people know that this boat is the only boat worth getting on. Amen. Would you pray with me? Father in heaven, we thank you so much for your word. And we thank you so much that you sent your one and only Son, our Saviour, the Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you that we are in the boat with him. And so we do pray that you would impress the preaching of your word by the power of your Spirit on the hearts of your people. And we do ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, let's stand and respond and sing a song of praise and praise to the Lord, the Almighty, the King of creation. We'll sing verses 1 to 3 before the benediction and verse 4 after the benediction. Please remain standing after verses 1 to 3. Well, if you're visiting today, please remember that we have coffee and tea over the hall next door, and we have a second worship service that starts at 5 p.m. Love to see you all back this afternoon as well, if you are able to come. Please lift up your hearts to receive the parting blessing from our Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you his peace. And all God's people said, Amen. 353, verse 4. Praise the Lord, the Almighty.